Good afternoon, everyone. We are very excited this afternoon to have this dynamic panel to discuss a very interesting topic. As was provided in the conference material app, we know today's panel, Amateurs No More, is to discuss. In 2010, the NCAA signed a $10 billion contract with CBS and Turner to cover men's basketball. In 2011, the Pac-12 signed a $3 billion contract with Fox and ESPN to cover sports. Contracts like these have led to a broadening discussion about what happens with the amateur athletes and are they able to recover and benefit from this huge revenue that entities are generating. This afternoon, to discuss these topics and others, we have Nicole Duckett. She will be moderating the panel, and she is a general counsel and vice president for the Los Angeles Clippers. Dr. Harry Edwards was on the faculty of the University of California, Berkeley, in the Department of Sociology from 1970 to 2001. Jeffrey Kessler is a partner with the law firm of Winston, Strawn, focusing his practice on antitrust competition, sports law, and complex litigation. Gary Plummer is a former football linebacker with the NFL and United States Football League. Beth Wilkinson is founding partner of Wilkinson, Walsh, and Escovitz. And also Bart Williams, partner with Proskauer Rose and one of the leading trial attorneys in the United States. We welcome them. We look forward to this dynamic and robust discussion. Nicole?
So we thought it would be helpful to provide some context with some factual background of our topic today, and specifically with respect to the commercialization of sports. So Jeff, you want to lead us off?
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining us. I'm going to start off with a little bit of a reality check on what does the business of Division I basketball and football look like today. Because if you haven't been paying close attention to this, you might find some of this at least surprising in terms of your vision of this is not the glee club. This is not even the rowing team. These are, as I will show, major business enterprises that have developed in the context of college sports. So what are we looking at? First of all of this is in the context of the NCAA's principle of amateurism, which they set forth in their manual. You can read that for yourself, but basically the idea is that the athletes will be exploited if they are compensated for being on the teams and the revenues that they generate, and that it's necessary to limit strictly what they can receive in exchange for being an athlete on these teams. And that's the backdrop in which this issue arises. So, first, let's take a look at, very quickly, the TV side of this money. ESPN, $5.64 billion over 12 years for the college football playoff system. These are numbers that rival professional football, that rival the NBA, that rival that. In fact, the total revenues for football and basketball in college sports would make college sports the second highest revenue generating sports business in the United States after the National Football League. It's more than the NBA, it's more than the NHL, it's more than Major League Baseball in terms of what they generate. The most recent power conference media rights agreements, those are the five conferences which have really run this as a business, paid out a total of $16 billion in terms of their multiple year agreements in those sports. And just recently, CBS and Turner paid $11 billion for the NCAA tournament rights extension in terms of that. So we are talking billions and billions of dollars being generated here. This is just a list of the sponsors that pay that. Every type of sponsor you can imagine is here. They even have Fiskars, who is the official scissors, to cut down the net in terms of that. Everything is sold in connection with the tournaments. They have official mugs for the drinks, and they actually have taken away people who came with a cat mug. This was a famous story in the New York Times at an NCAA game, but it didn't have the sponsor's logo on it, so their mug had to be taken away in terms of that. The revenues are at the conference level and at the school level. I'm not going to cover all this because we want to set this up for the questions. This just gives you some of the individual power conference numbers, and this is important because what we contend is the conferences have in effect become individual sports leagues. They compete on their own, they compete against each other, and they own, in many cases, their own TV networks. So that if you're a fan of the Big Ten, you'll watch the Big Ten TV network, which they own in partnership with ESPN. That's how they run that together. Now, as a result, because you cannot pay the athletes, where does this money go? Well, they're nonprofit institutions, so they have to spend it somewhere. You could say, oh, well, maybe they spend it on, I don't know, education? No. So what you look at, and I just lost my, I don't know what happened to the thing. I mean, you get to see me, which is okay. But you'll see the money flows to the conference commissioners who will make over $2 million a year on average. It flows to the coaches. So you'll have a coach like Nick Saban, who will make over $11 million a year to be a college football coach. But that's not the most astounding thing. The weight coach on the University of Alabama makes $500,000 a year for the football team. That is more than the president of the University of Alabama. In most states, the highest paid government official by far that has these teams will have a college coach or an athletic director as the highest paid officials in the state. So here are some of them. You can see Nick Saban's $11.1 million. Krzyzewski on Duke, $9 million. So the money has to go somewhere. As I mentioned, FDS football and D1 basketball coaches always, and much more than the presidents of these schools. And this is just a list of some of the data that shows that as well. And their assistant coaches, as I mentioned, earn more than the presidents also. So, looking at an individual school level, 28 schools reported revenues of over $100 million last year from their sports. Okay, largely D1 basketball and what they call FBS football, which is the highest level of football. It's a $100 million business operating inside these schools. The athletic directors, as I mentioned, earn most of them more than $1 million a year. And where else does the money go? It goes into these incredible facilities, and the reason is the only way they can compete for the athletes if they can't give them any compensation is so they build separate palaces and facilities that get paid in. Hundreds of millions of dollars get spent on this, and these are just some examples of some of the type of facilities. By the way, different from what other students have, different from the rest of the campus. Is this an efficient use of this money? That's what you have to ask yourself. Now, at the same time that the revenues are soaring, and the coaches' salaries are soaring, and the athletic director salaries are soaring. What is the graduation data for this? Well, unfortunately, the reality is that the graduation rate for men's D1 basketball players lags behind that of the other students and athletes. So the very one that's generating all the money is lagging behind in the graduation rate. The Department of Education data shows that the graduation rate for all college athletes is 68%, and for men's D1 basketball players, it's 48%. This is a problem. At the power conference schools, 55.2% of the black athletes in football and basketball graduated within 6 years. That sounds like, well, that's not so bad, except that 69.3% of all athletes and 76.3% of all undergraduate students graduated within 6 years. So the athletes are graduating at a lower rate, and they're not being compensated for it either in terms of that. At the same time, the NCAA, which imposes these regulations, disclaims responsibility for ensuring that the athletes get an education. At the University of North Carolina, some of you may have read, there was a major scandal where they had basically fake classes that they were going to. And the NCAA was actually sued over this. And what their response was the following. This is from the NCAA response and their motion to dismiss. The NCAA defers to its member schools to determine whether academic fraud occurred, and ultimately, the NCAA is bound to making decisions within the rules set by the membership. Basically, the NCAA imposed no sanctions, took no responsibility, said it's up to the individual schools. So the question to be posed, if the education of these students is up to the individual schools, why isn't the decision as to whether to compensate them up to the individual schools? Why isn't the decision to let the conferences to decide how they should be treated? Why does the NCAA set one rule that regulates the money but does nothing really to protect the educational values in terms of this? Just recently, there was a set of criminal investigations that were widely reported for under-the-table payments to athletes by sneaker companies, to coaches, to others. And it was so bad that the NCAA formed a task force and a commission on this. What many observers have asked, if you bottle up this system and you're generating hundreds of millions of dollars and it can't flow naturally to those who are generating the money, where will it go? Well, it goes is places like under-the-table payments that raise criminal issues and others. The NCAA formed the Commission on College Football, and this was their conclusion. The Independent Commission on College, basketball, not football. The Independent Commission on College Basketball was established on October 1, 2017 to assess the state of the enterprise and to recommend transformational changes to address the multiple issues and challenges. To me, that's the issue for this panel. What are the transformational changes that are necessary in order to make this system fair, just, and consistent with legal and other values of this country? So thank you very much. That's my part of the factual background. You now hear from the NCAA. They may have a slightly different perspective on this.
Thank you, Jeff. I'd like Beth to come up and share some of her thoughts on the background of our issues today.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I will say that none of us are speaking on behalf officially of our clients. But there is another side to the story. It's a fascinating issue, and there's a lot more really at stake than what you just heard. Because it isn't just about Division I basketball and football, and for those of you who follow sports, you know that even when you talk about Division I football and basketball, there are many different teams and many different universities and colleges that have very diverse resources. People like to talk about the 28 schools that Jeff talked about, but there's 350 plus schools in Division I. And college sports are popular because not just because of basketball and football, although those are extremely popular, but because students can go be athletes and play all kinds of sports. So when the NCAA makes their rules and the universities vote on those rules, they aren't just to govern basketball and football. The general principle of aligning athletics with academics is supposed to deal with all athletes who are students. But there is a lot of money in college sports, and why is that? Why do these television networks pay so much money for the contracts? Because consumers, you and others, love to watch college sports. And why do you love to watch college sports more, I guess, Jeff was showing us, than some of the major league sports? Because they're different. They're unique. There's something about college sports. We saw it just this season. I'm a little biased. I have three children who are basketball players, so I will tell most of my stories about basketball. But if you look, there's 460,000 college athletes across 24 sports. And for football, there were 28.4 million viewers. But the stories we heard most about recently were from March Madness. And March Madness, you see the picture up there. One of the best sweetheart stories was the University of Maryland in Baltimore County. Probably almost nobody in this room had heard of that university beforehand. It's a small college division of the Maryland school system. It's not in the most wealthy area. It teaches engineers, focuses on engineers and scientists. They had a, contrary to the big facilities you saw about, they had a tiny facility until this year that sat only over 4,000 fans. It was a one multi-purpose athletic facility for 13,000 students. They couldn't even have their graduation there, let alone have a big crowd. And despite that, this year during March Madness, they beat Virginia, University of Virginia, the number one seed. So while there are examples that you heard about these big fancy facilities, and there's some good reasons for that, we'll talk about that later, that is not true of the vast majority of athletic facilities around the country where the vast majority of students participate in sports. And the reason that this model is the best of, let's say, how it could get so much worse with the suggestions that you just heard, is because paying the players will only exacerbate all the problems that you just heard about. So what happens when more money goes? We know, we looked at the coaches, right? You just saw the coaches' salaries. Those salaries were the NCAA tried to regulate those, and the courts told them no. So what took over? The market system took over. And what did the market do? It distinguished among the better coaches and the worst coaches, and you have those large salaries. So the question here, I think, today is also not just should you pay the players, what should happen to those revenues, but what's going to happen if you decide to pay players? What are going to be the results? Because you can have small schools that do well, you can have big schools who aren't so successful, but the one thing they all have in common is that they are integrating the academics and the athletics for the students. There are examples, of course, exceptions to the rules, but the general opportunity for students are to go to school, get an education, play sports, and come out of college without debt. And I think in today's society, we all know most of the complaints about college these days are that the average graduate comes out with over $27,000 of debt. If you go and get a D1 scholarship for basketball or football, you get a full scholarship, you don't come out with any debt, and you have the chance, as Dr. Rice said, who championed and chaired that committee we just heard about, to get an education and a degree. Does that mean everyone does? No, but that's true of students who don't play sports. And what does that degree mean? We all know that the statistics show over and over again that that means that you have a better chance at a stronger economic life throughout your career, throughout your life. That is one of the most distinguishing factors in our country. We saw it with the GI Bill, and we've seen it with student athletes who can transform, and students in general, transform their economic chances by going to college. The whole purpose, as the NCAA says, of bringing in sports is to make that part of the learning experience for the athletes and the other students who don't play sports. But does the NCAA really put its money where its mouth is? That's one of the questions, I think a fair question Mr. Kessler asked. Well, what happens to the revenues? Most of the revenues are controlled. The football revenues are not controlled by the NCAA. The NCAA only collects the revenues for March Madness, for basketball. And they disseminate those revenues. They're a nonprofit, but they don't keep all of that money. They disseminate it mostly to the schools who participated in the tournament. And it pays for the $2.4 billion of scholarships. They set up additional funds for student assistance where people can have other needs, everything from going home to a funeral to having family travel that can be paid for from that fund and others like it, an academic enhancement fund, championships, and allocation to the other sports in Division II and III that don't have nearly the resources. So the questions here are complicated, and the statistics are also, I think, different than what you heard. So I'm going to turn it over to Bart to talk about that.
Good afternoon, everybody. Again, let me reiterate what Beth said. I'm not here in my capacity representing any particular client, merely to express my own opinions. But I wanted to talk a little bit more about some of the statistics that Beth mentioned a moment ago. Only 24 of the 347 Division I athletic programs have a positive net generated revenue. That's about 6.9%. So we're talking about 93% of the programs operating in the red. The average FBS athletic program, and that stands for the Football Bowl Subdivision that we all know about, the major bowl level of football, generates only 81% of the money that it spends. And the remainder comes from the universities involved, or student fees, or from government entities. The average FCS, or Football Championship Subdivision, and that relates to what used to be called the level of Division I AA, those programs generate only about 29% of the money that they spend. The average Division I athletic program without a football program generates only 23% of the money that it spends. And when the money does come in, when the money is generated from those few schools that have actual programs that operate in the green, football, basketball, at some schools, that money funds all of the other athletic endeavors at those universities. So all of the other sports, everything from volleyball to tennis to lacrosse, men's and women's, gymnastics where available, swimming. And we'll talk a little bit later about what's happening at universities around America and the necessary cutbacks that are occurring in those programs. But the fact of the matter is that the money that is generated pays for all of those other programs. So it isn't the case that these individual programs are operating like a business. If they were, then all of these other sports would be in jeopardy. If they were, then Title IX would be very difficult to comply with, because currently the funds that come from the profit-generating sports go to fund the women's athletics. There are only very, very few women's programs that actually generate in the green. Those are a couple of basketball programs around the nation. There's a lot that has been said about whether student athletes are students. Some of the facts are that surveys of the students that have graduated in recent years are that 90% of the student athletes who graduate say that they have a professor who makes them excited to learn. 65% say they have a professor who cares about them as a person. More than 90% say they feel positively about their choice of a major. And the reference to the University of North Carolina example is telling. All that was concluded there by the NCAA was that the NCAA was not going to invade the purview of the University of North Carolina. The University of North Carolina had investigated and determined that the results of that the classes involved there were the same for non-athletes as they were for athletes. There was some corruption involved in those courses for whomever took those classes, and not just for the student athletes. Hence, the NCAA came to the conclusion that this was not a case where they should insert themselves into the decision-making process. But how about graduation rates? Because the statistics that you heard Jeff Kessler mention were comparing black athletes with graduation rates for all students, or black athletes with other athletes. Well, the fact is that 68% of student athletes graduate. That's similar to the statistic that Jeff mentioned. But what he didn't tell you is that 66% of the general student body graduates. The athletes graduate at a higher percentage. And if you focus on subsets of those groups, for example, if you look at the demographic of African-American student athletes, let's take African-American male student athletes, they graduate at a rate of 55%. But the overall graduation rate for African-American students is only 40%. The graduation rate of the athletes is higher than that of the non-athletes. The same, and even more so, for African-American female student athletes who graduate at a 67% rate compared with 49% for similarly situated non-athletic African-American female students. After college, about 1.6% of football players get into the NFL, 1.2% of basketball players go to the NBA, less than 1% of women basketball players go to the WNBA. Yet the stories that you hear, the narrative that one hears, is focused on those very few who are able to go pro. And I'm here to tell you, as a former college athlete, I played basketball for 4 years in Division I, that the vast majority of the people who play Division I athletics are not people who believe that they are going to be professional athletes. They recognize that. I figured that out about age 13. It becomes clear after a while. And the few who are not focused on that, and the folks who haven't become realistic about it, are no different than the other students who go to college and aren't focused. There are folks who go to college and don't go to class who are not student athletes. Indeed, at the major universities for Division I athletics, the athletes have to go to class. They're proctored to go to class. They are followed to make sure that they go to class. 82% of student athletes who graduate are employed at what they self-describe as their desired level versus 78% for the non-student athletes. The graduation rates for student athletes have risen. It's coincided with the explosion in the revenues for college sports. I can't say that it's a causal connection, I don't know. But it certainly correlates, going from 52% in 1991 up to that 68% from 2017. There's no question that with the increased revenue, there is more money that can go back into the programs for support systems for the student athletes. But I still am not in a place where I could say that it's a causal connection. So finally, and then we'll get to talking with each other. College basketball, like college sports generally, is to be played by student athletes who are members of the collegiate community and who are not paid professionals. That was the conclusion of the Commission on College Basketball that was chaired by Condoleezza Rice. Thanks, we'll talk more.
Thank you, Bart. So with that context, I'd really like to ask the panel if college athletes really are amateurs, and if so, by what definition? I'd like to start with you, Dr. Edwards.
I can't hear, the acoustics in here are so bad that I didn't even hear the question, but.
If we would agree that college athletes are indeed amateurs, and if so, by what definition?
No, they're not amateurs. The only amateurs involved in college sports are those who believe that they're amateurs. I think part of what you have heard is validation of the old saw that there are lies, damn lies, and then there are statistics. When you compare black athletes to the black student, hey, didn't cut me off already. when you compare black athletes to the average black student, and claim any kind of equity in terms of graduation rates for those athletes, that's not valid. The average black student drops out of school because of a lack of financial support. Athletes come in with financial support and some kind of tacit agreement that you will have an ethical and equitable opportunity to achieve a college education. And not only do black athletes graduate in disproportionately low numbers, many of them cannot afford to go back to the schools that they represent and finish their degrees, not in 6 years, not in 7 years, not in 10 years, because they don't have the money. And as was stated, they don't go into the pros. They go in and essentially pay the mortgages, support the other sports in the school for the period of their eligibility, but these comparisons are not valid. Anybody who believes that the statements on profit really doesn't understand how this whole process works. Profit is one of those is a very strange concept. At some point, it comes down to who's keeping the books, and many of these college programs are under circumstances where toward the end of the year, one way or another, they zero themselves out. They're getting state money, they're getting money from sponsors, they're getting all kinds of funds coming in. And the bottom line is that everybody is being paid. This thing is built on the backs of people who are not compensated. And we're not talking about badminton and water polo and women's gymnastics. We're talking about men's basketball and football. And when you look at those sports and begin to talk about not pay, but compensation, it's not a matter of taking money away from women's sports and so forth. It's compensation. These athletes, the NCAA is selling cups. The NCAA is selling, NCAA and these colleges and universities have shoe sponsorships, all kinds of stuff, but the athletes have nothing. They don't even have an agent. Athletes should be compensated for the work that they do, for the money that they bring in. Everybody is organized, athletic directors, college presidents, coaches, trainers, everybody is organized, and everybody is getting paid, except the athletes on whose backs these empires are built. And don't tell anybody old Edwards told you so. But even Rip Van Winkle eventually woke up. And what you're looking at now, especially in the age of the social media, is an increasing pressure to compensate these athletes. Everybody wants to push this into, well, pay, does the quarterback get less than a running back? And what about the women's sports? None of that, it comes into compensation. So if an agent can parlay a shoe contract for an athlete at a university, then why can't he do that? The coach is doing it, the school is doing it, the athletic department is doing it. Why can't he receive compensation from control of his image? Why can't he receive compensation from other kinds of sponsorships and so forth that he might be involved in? Everybody else is doing it, and this idea that it'll destroy amateurism, hey, they started playing Olympic athletes. They started getting compensation with shoe deals and everything. It didn't destroy the Olympics. The Olympics are bigger now than they ever were. So you can't tell me anything about compensation. And as far as women are concerned, look, you can be honest when you can't be right. If Maya Moore is playing at Connecticut or someplace and a shoe company wants to come in and cut a deal with her and give her $100,000 over her years of eligibility or whatever deal it is, that's fine. If somebody wants to come in, if nobody wants to give the women's badminton team captain a contract, hey, they call it capitalism. And so at the end of the day, all of this stuff is really orchestrated to figure out a way how they can maintain this plantation system of abject serfdom as far as these athletes are concerned. And because so often they can't leave the schools without penalties, it goes beyond serfdom. You're talking about a slave system, and they're disproportionately minorities and black, which goes to the heart in many instances of the discussion of compensation. So, look, let's see if we can have an honest discussion about this
rather than these statistics that are flying all over the place and these fairy tales about what's going to happen with the water polo team. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about collegiate basketball and football and the fact that it's organized on a plantation structure of exploitation where the athletes are inordinately and disproportionately black. If you look at Alabama playing Clemson last year in the national championship, it looked like Ghana playing Nigeria. That's where this thing is, and that's what we have to deal with.
Thank you, Dr. Edwards. So let me ask the question directly. Dr. Edwards, you've shared with us your thoughts that the athletes should certainly be compensated. And Beth, you mentioned in your comments sort of some of the things that could go wrong if they were paid. So let me ask some of our other panelists. Gary, how do you feel about college athletes being paid?
Well, I walked on at the University of California at Berkeley, and I became a starting nose tackle at 228 pounds. I had worked three jobs to save up. It was somewhere around $5,000 I thought it was going to take to get me through in order to make the team. And I did that and still didn't get a scholarship, even though I was a starting nose tackle at Cal, until I went into the coach's offices my senior year and said, I ran out of money, so I have to quit. And fortunately, they came up with a mystery scholarship for me. But those times that I look back on are some of the greatest times of my life because they taught me so much. I grew up in a two-bedroom condo with seven of us, and there wasn't much to eat. And going into Cal, I was able to draw on that experience. And then later in my life, having to go to Cal, compete on the football field, and then also in the classroom, it was something more difficult than I'd ever done, because the way you grow up, that's just normal for you. When I made it to Cal, it was extremely difficult. And so later on, and one of the things we're talking about is compensating athletes, I went through three collective bargaining agreements in the NFL. And they were brutal times because nobody knows how much you're supposed to pay to different people. And what's going to happen to college football if you're only paying the superstars? There's going to be a lot of inequity and a lot of people that aren't going to be happy about being teammates. It's going to create dissension in the locker room. I just think it's a really bad idea. I think, as we've seen before, I agree with Doc 100% statistics. I don't know any of these statistics. All I know is that the experience of playing college football was one of the greatest that I ever experienced in my life, and without it, I probably never would have gotten one of these, Doc. I know you're wearing one, too.
What is that?
That Super Bowl ring you have over there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, that's
business,
right?
Thank you,
Gary. Bart, you played basketball in college, something I didn't know until now, by the way. What are your thoughts on college athletes being paid?
I don't believe they should be paid. I believe that folks who argue that they're being exploited are not focusing on the value that comes to the college athlete who's receiving a scholarship. There's a tremendous economic value there. There's a tremendous value on top of the economic value. So the generational change that occurs when you have students, particularly those who are from a background for example, I played in college on a team where half of the kids were from struggling socioeconomic backgrounds. They received the grant and aids that was at least 90% of what was necessary to get through college. Most of them were from families, half the guys on the team were from families that didn't have other people who'd gone to college. It changes everything about those families. So I refuse to believe that the college athletes are being exploited. I think that all you have to do is look around and look at the people that you, the people in this room have come across who are captains of industry, men and women. I think I read a statistic recently where 52% of the CEOs who are women, female CEOs in America, played college sports. 94% of them played high school sports. There is a connection between sports and success in life, and the data shows that college athletes graduate at a higher rate than people who are similarly situated, and that they make more money in their 20s, mid-20s, than people who are similarly situated. If only 1% of the people are playing professionally, that tells you that it's really the other folks who are doing better, and that's for obvious reasons, because of the lessons that the athletics teach us.
You mentioned women and some correlations there. Jeff, let me ask you, what do you think the impact would be on women's sports if we were to pay or not pay college athletes?
So competition would be great for everybody, including women's sports. Why? Let's look at how the issue of exploitation can be looked at. This is not about the players I'm looking at my right and left who made it to professional sports. As stated very aptly, 95% of these athletes on these big revenue sports don't go to the NFL and don't go to the NBA. Their only opportunity to ever realize any financial gain out of their tremendous talents to generate hundreds of millions of dollars is when they're in school generating this money, because they're not going to the NFL, the NBA. So you're a poor minority kid on Alabama, and you're one of the unfortunate ones in that 45% who don't graduate. Would it hurt people so much if Nick Saban made $2 million left? He only made $9 million. And that $2 million got spread out equally to all the members on that team, and some for the women's basketball players too, to help the women athletes as well, who also deserve that, whether you're on Alabama or not. This is not a question of extremes. If you let the individual conferences decide, the SEC, what's a fair rule, they could decide what's a fair rule. But if you're letting it be decided by the 300 plus members who aren't in these sports businesses, then you're not getting a fair economic result. And from the issue of women, some people said, what about Title IX? Well, if Title IX applies to this, this means if there's more money for the athletes, more must go to the women, because Title IX says so. Okay? So this is not an impediment for doing things for the women. If there were more money available, there'd be more money available. Right now, when you saw the charts that were put up, they were proudly said there's $71 million go to Division II and Division III sports. That's out of over $2.8 billion distributed by the NCAA tournament that year. Where is the money going? So yes, I think it would benefit women's sport. I think it would benefit the athletes. It would prevent this exploitation. It doesn't have to go to the superstars. It just doesn't have to be this current system, which is designed to take these huge businesses and direct all these revenues in a way that it keeps it from those people who do the most to generate it and need it the most.
Thank you, Jeff. Beth, you alluded, did you want to say something?
this is something. All of a sudden, everybody's making money and getting rich. But when the people who are producing the money, all of a sudden the money is going to destroy them. The average athlete on a campus, on scholarship, does not live at the level of the average student because the money that he's given on scholarship doesn't cover that lifestyle. They don't live at the level of the average student on the campus that they're at. This idea that of having to pay them, I'm not even saying that you have to pay them. I'm saying, why not let them sign a shoe deal? Why not let them have control of their own images? Why not let them do sponsorships? And during the Olympic Games, if somebody is the world's fastest human, nobody's worried about, well, the guy that came in sixth is going to feel bad because the world's fastest human has a shoe deal. That's not the way this country works. Everybody, if money was that bad, then everybody in collegiate athletics, from the athletic directors, the head coaches, the weight trainers, the assistant coaches, everybody who is organized and making money, they must be corrupt as hell. So what I'm saying is, if it doesn't corrupt Nick Saban to be making $11 million, then how is an athlete on that team who can sign a shoe deal for $50,000 a year while he's there, producing all of that money, how is this going to destroy him? I don't get that. And as far as the women are concerned, if it is organ, they can figure out a way to compensate the athletes. And that is not something that has to involve every athlete on campus. If somebody wants to give, as I stated, a woman basketball player endorsement deal, that's fine. But if they don't, then that's the way the system works. But the athletes who are producing the money should have that opportunity. And by the way, again, don't tell anybody old Edwards told you so, but there's an existential threat to women's sports where whether or not they're paid or not is not even going to matter. If the assaults on Roe v. Wade and so forth continue, people talk about Title IX in 1972, but what they don't talk about is Roe v. Wade in 1973, which opened up all these clinics so that a school who gave a woman a scholarship, a pro team that gave a woman a contract, knows that if they give her that scholarship in September, she's going to be there in March to play in the basketball game, or in June to run in the track and field meet. If these assaults continue, then the very foundations of women's sports is going to be eroded. It may not immediately impact the women who are already in college, but it's going to impact the pool. So these assaults on Roe v. Wade are an existential threat to the existence of women's sports. Whether or not they're paid could become a purely academic question if things continue to roll out as they are, such as in Texas, where they moved from 44 clinics for women down to 14 with only four with admissions rates at hospitals, which means, as one young lady told me, she had to drive 500 miles to get the services that she needed. So all I'm saying is this, that it is organizationally increasingly unmanageable, it is politically increasingly untenable, and it is morally increasingly unconscionable for these billions of dollars to be made, built on the backs of young men who cannot even afford, in most instances, to go out after they put millions of dollars in the coffers of a school and buy a hamburger for them and their dates. They cannot even afford to buy their own jerseys in the school store. That is just wrong. It's not an issue of economic equity. It's an issue of economic justice.
Thank you, Dr. Edwards. Beth, you had alluded in your opening comments that there would be issues if we were to pay college athletes. What are your thoughts on what the implications would be on women's sports if we were to do that, or if we weren't to do that?
Well, I think we heard Well, if you just listen to some of the perspectives we heard, you can see the differences, because Mr. Kessler was talking about everyone getting paid the same amount and everyone getting paid, and Dr. Edwards was talking about the market system working. If you're going to lift the rules, you're going to have a market system, and you have 460,000 college athletes. How many of those people are going to get sneaker contracts? About 10. And so you're going to have, what Gary was saying, the difference between the vast majority of student athletes who aren't going to get any money for playing, and no sneaker contracts, and the few superstars, which is going to create a lot of dissension among the teams and the students and the players who are there to play together. So this idea that the market system, yes, it'll work. That's like saying the banks will be really nice, let's just not regulate them and we'll see how they'll do. There will be a market for those athletes, and we know what's happened because we've seen what's happened to coaches. And do we really think that coaches are gonna make less if we start to pay athletes and you're gonna have worse facilities? That's absurd. They're not gonna stop paying the coaches. The reason in part these coaches are paid is because they have accomplished careers and these students wanna go be coached by the best coaches, the best trainers, and go to the best facilities. Now, most of the students don't get that, but certainly the system, if you say you're gonna pay athletes, is not going to stop paying the coaches and building those facilities and doing all the other things they're gonna do. What they're going to do is still have a limited pool of money and cut the sports that don't generate revenue. Because you'll hear from lots of people who run universities, like the chancellor of the University of Wisconsin, who she's a very accomplished economist, and she said, if I ran this like a business, I would probably just keep football, and some schools they would just keep basketball, and I would cut all the other sports because they're not revenue generating, instead of paying the 460,000 student athletes the same amount as Mr. Kessler was talking about. And what happens if you pay those athletes? Even if you could pay everyone equally, do we really think that student athletes are gonna spend more time on academics when they're getting paid for being athletes? Again, I have children. I'm pretty sure when I pay my kid more to do something, they're more inclined to do that than especially pay attention to school. And there's no recognition here that not everyone is a student like many of the accomplished people here. Many athletes, and I always use one of my own children as an example, one of the things that focuses them on academics is athletics. Not every kid is a straight-A student. Not every kid wants to go to school. And many of these athletes want to go to school and want to be athletes and focus more on their academics because they want to play college sports. Those are the kids that are not going to get paid. They're not going to make a ton of money. And I think the rationale is, from Mr. Kessler, well, this is the only time that these folks can cash in. That's ridiculous, too. You think most of these people are gonna cash in at all, and if they are, it's gonna be a few thousand dollars for most of these kids in a short time period, instead of what they get from a lifetime of a college education and from being athletes? I mean, I think I should stop talking and let Gary talk again about what you get from being a student and an athlete and how that affects your entire career instead of having an extra $10,000 or $15,000 over a four-year period.
I would just, again, to Mr. Kessler's point about, you know, it's the only opportunity for some of these people, some of these athletes, to make money. I mean, you're pigeonholing athletes and saying, well, basically you're not smart enough to get a degree. The only way you're gonna make money in your life is to get it right now. And to me, that's embarrassing. It's ridiculous. That's a terrible argument. And I feel like that's exploitation of college athletes. Again, one of the greatest experiences of my life, and yes, it was a struggle, Doc. It was, because my parents had no money, and I did it all on my own, and I had to work. But that's what enabled me to understand that the more you give, the more you get. You get out of life what you put into it. And working hard, those are the lessons that we're trying to teach our kids. I have four kids myself, and this entitled generation is just gonna become more entitled if we throw money at them. And just one more thing, if I start talking about professional athletes, we understand, and I don't know how correct the statistic is, but supposedly 82% of all NFL players within 3 years of retirement are either broke, divorced, or have a criminal record. That might be high, I don't know. But if that happens to guys that are in their mid-20s, because the average age of an NFL player is 26 and a half, that means that it's gonna happen a heck of a lot more with giving a ton of money to 18 and 19-year-old kids These are kids we're talking about that don't know how to handle money. And so if you put it in, I agree that they should get more. They should get more services. They should get more tutoring. They should get something put in a pot so that if they don't graduate on time, they can go back and get that degree, no matter how long it takes them. Those would be great things, because then they could have something to work towards. To your point, Mr. Williams, that most guys aren't going to end up being professional athletes, but if they go back and get that degree, they can be successful.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask a different question. Are there constituents other than the colleges and the universities that would be impacted if we were to pay these athletes? Bart, what are your thoughts on that? Or Jeff, did you have something to say?
Well, I was just going to add, and it picks up on what's being said by Mr. Plummer. There are many communities, mm-hmm. and let's start with the communities of these athletes. So Paul Tagliabue, former commissioner of the NFL, I don't know if he was the commissioner when you were mm-hmm. playing. Okay, he's now the chairman of Georgetown. He said if he was freed from these restrictions of the NCAA, what he would do is he would put aside $25,000 for each Georgetown basketball player every year they made progress towards their degree. And when they got their degree, he would put another sum of money, let's say another $50,000 in, and he would use this to encourage them to get their education, have that money, and go back to their communities where this is not a tip. Okay, if you can walk away with $200,000 as a Georgetown player who's not going to play in the NBA and take that back to your poor community, that is life-changing for that community. That is life-changing for that athlete. And if you got rid of these regulations, the conference that Georgetown plays in could allow their schools to do that. But Paul Tagliabue can't do that because the NCAA rules won't let him do that. And if we decentralize this to the conferences, you could design things to accomplish exactly what you're talking about in encouraging them. Right now, you can't. You could take it to health. Schools could, if they wanted to, without these rules, have a lifetime fund for football players if they get CTE later in their life for what they're doing for their schools. If a conference wanted to allow that now, guess what? They can't do it. Because the NCAA says that would be compensation for being an athlete. So there, and that would affect the whole community, not to mention the medical community and everyone else in terms of this. So there are lots of parts of the world that are affected by these rules. And it is not an extreme. It doesn't have to be just unregulated competition, because individual conferences could decide what to do. And individual boards of trustee, like Georgetown by Paul Tagliabue, could decide what to do. So if you let a little competition in here and you remove this broad restriction that makes no sense, you're going to see benefits for every community up and down the road.
Bart, do you think there are other constituents that would be affected besides the schools themselves?
I do. Excuse me, I do. I think, though, the fundamental point is that the focus is on universities. We're talking about educational institutions and universities. We're not talking about profit-making organizations. We're talking about organizations that exist for the purpose of educating young men and women and preparing them for their lives. To look at it and say, well, if you just allow the conferences to do it, there'll just be little small tweaks. I beg to differ. If the rules that currently exist at the NCAA to limit pay for play for athletes, or to limit benefits or the amounts or put caps on benefits for athletes, are removed, what you will see rush in is competition in the sense of boosters trying to get a player to come to a particular school. You give me 500 signatures, I'll pay you $1 million. just come to NC State. If there are no controls, which is the reason for the NCAA rules, is to limit just that type of violation of the amateurism ideal. These are universities, and the universities have a parental role. So in some universities, say the University of Notre Dame, it's actually a codified presidential parental role at the time that a student enrolls there. But all of the universities see themselves as having a duty to help the student athletes become men and women. If you create a situation where the focus isn't on the academic part of their studenthood, but rather on the athletic part, that's where they're going to spend their time. There's no question about it. It's true in any organization. If you compensate certain behavior, that's the behavior that people are going to engage in. And so the idea is that the universities are trying to create a balance between the ability to participate in the sports and all the benefits that come with that, the ability to get a college education and a degree, which helps in every way in life and does allow people to change their communities when they go back, when that 99% goes back to their communities. That's how they make a difference. So my view is that everybody's going to be affected if we convert college athletics to something else, to professional athletics. If someone really wants to play professional athletics, basketball, for example, they can do that right now. If they're good enough, they can go to Europe. They could go to the G League or the Gatorade League, which is the developmental league for the NBA. If they don't want to go to school, they don't have to go to school. But if they go to school, there are certain things that are incumbent upon them, and that's for a reason.
Thank you. This next question I'd really like to hear from all of you on, but I would like to start with Gary, given him being a former NFL player, and that is, what impact would all of this have on health and safety, particularly with respect to football in light of the concussion issue?
So I was diagnosed with the early stages of dementia 3 years ago, and it was a former teammate of mine, Junior Seau, committing suicide, and my wife telling me that it's time to go see a counselor that changed my life. I went to see a counselor. She gave me some suggestions, and I know this will surprise you, Doc, but going and meditating and doing yoga, listening to classical music, all those from a Neanderthal middle linebacker in the NFL, has made a huge difference. I guess we could debate this too, but I'm somewhere between 50 and 75% better through those things. So I think that one of the great things about America is that when there's a problem, we find a solution. And CTE has definitely been a problem. I was up in Seattle coaching with Kenny Norton a few weeks ago and noticed that the helmets that used to cost $250 are now $2,500 because they're putting a lot more research into it. There's still a long way to go. They've changed some of the rules in the NFL. There's still more that needs to happen. Also, I think they need to put accelerometers into helmets so that they can monitor that from the sidelines, and when it reaches a certain threshold, the person is out. So they can definitely make the game safer. And the good news is we knew nothing about this. I went to a conference of neurologists and neurosurgeons about 20 years ago when they started telling us that there were three grades of concussions. And I had no idea. I thought a concussion was only when you got knocked out. But they explained that a grade one concussion, when you see stars or feel slightly disoriented, you need to sit out, or at least think about sitting out. Well, if you don't have 5 to 10 of those a game as a middle linebacker, then that means you didn't play that game. So even having somewhere in the neighborhood after 15 years of professional football, somewhere around 2,500 concussions, through neuroplasticity, I've been able to reverse a lot of the effects of that. And I think it's a positive message for the NCAA, for the NFL, that this doesn't have to be a death sentence. And again, there should be a solution to every problem.
Dr. Edwards, what are your thoughts on what implications there would be on health and safety if we were to pay or not pay?
You know, I interviewed athletes at the Combine for the San Francisco 49ers for 18 years. And invariably, after interviewing an athlete, the coaches would be sitting in the room, and when we evaluated the athlete after they left, somebody would say, oh, he's a great player, but he's not too bright. And I virtually, in every case, there was suspicion on my part, and I talked to Bill Walsh about it often, that it wasn't that the kid wasn't bright. He had already taken too many hits. And in point of fact, I would estimate, as I told Bill eventually, that somewhere between 15 and 20% of the athletes that I interviewed were already showing signs of having taken too many hits. My father was a boxer. I knew what that looked like. When I went to college, boxing was a college sport. I had fellow athletes on campus at San Jose State who I knew had taken too many hits. And so I knew the syndrome when I saw it, and this was from 1985 up until about 1995, 96, when it really became clear that there was an issue in that regard. Now, there is just so much hitting you can take out of football before it becomes dodgeball. We already have positions that are that way. The quarterback position, the kicker, the punter, you can't line up over the center, you can't line up over the long snapper. But it's not just the head injuries, it's the concussive impact of moving full speed and then all of a sudden coming to a dead halt. The brain continues to move. I don't know what the solution is to it. I don't know if it can be solved. I know that flag football is not the answer. Football is one of those sports that's uniquely American because you got to grow up taking those hits. And it's like baseball. If you're not a baseball fan by the time you're 11, 12 years old, you'll never be a baseball fan. If you haven't grown up taking those hits where you have instinctually know where the next hit is coming from, you're not going to, the first time you get up looking through your helmet, you looking through the ear hole of your helmet, you're going to make up your mind, I don't want to play football anymore. I'm not sure that there's a solution to it. I've talked to doctors. I've been around it for the last 31 years that I've been with the 49ers. I don't know that there's a solution to it. And I think that for that reason, it's imperiled. But I also know this, that football is going to become overwhelmingly black for that reason. In the next two college generations, football at the elite level, Division I level and NFL level, are going to be overwhelmingly black because that's who's playing. They have less opportunities. There's a distrust of the medical profession in black culture. And as one mother in Oakland told me, who has two sons playing collegiate sport and two in high school, playing collegiate Division I football and two in high school, you're going to tell me about something that might impact my son 25 years from now in terms of his head, when he can get his head blown off here on the way to football practice? No, he's going to play football. So at the end of the day, all of these issues of exploitation and so forth are going to be compounded by the concussion issue and the political optics of these athletes on the field taking hits in Division I sports, in football in particular, while people are making billions of dollars off of them and they cannot even afford to buy their jersey in a store, it's going to become organizationally increasingly unmanageable. This is not an issue of just, as I stated, equality. It's an issue of economic justice, and it's all of one fabric. We're talking about a multi-billion dollar free enterprise business embedded in an educational institution, and if anybody tells you anything other than this, they're not being telling you the truth. The universities do not control the athletic departments. The tail is wagging the dog. That has been the case for a number of years now.
if somebody has to get fired, I'll guarantee you it will not be Nick Saban at Alabama if he gets into it with the president of the school. The president of the school is gone. So we have to deal with these things honestly. The concussion issue is directly tied to the compensation issue, which is tied to a racial optics issue that is already well this side of the social political horizon and that people are going to have to deal with. What is not dealt with reason and rationality will ultimately be dealt with rebellion. I absolutely guarantee it.
Thank you, Dr. Edwards. Beth, what are your thoughts on the public health and safety issues?
I think I should defer any comments on that because I represent several of the sports leagues, but I can only say that I think if people think, and there are problems at the professional level, if you're going to pay athletes, I think you're only going to have more incentive for players to want to stay on the field because they want the money, or for coaches to keep them in because they want the money. So I don't see how, again, paying athletes will do anything but make those problems more difficult. And again, Gary's much more of an expert on that than I am. I never played any college sports, which is probably obvious. But I did have an ROTC scholarship for 4 years, and I had to go serve for 4 years in the Army to pay back my money. And like you, it was very tough. It was not my thing. And I learned more lessons from that and than I did from almost anything I've done in my life since then. So maybe I'm a little biased from having a scholarship. Bart may feel the same way, and we know a lot of those folks who did. I can only say that I think paying someone at the age of our kids to do something they already love to do and they're already devoted, I think we need to really honor those athletes. They are very disciplined people by the time they get to college and they're doing those sports, and they do them mostly because they love the sport. And I don't think that introducing the extreme economics that we're talking about, and Jeff, if you'll correct me on the math, but if someone were to pay $200,000 or set that aside at Georgetown, and your theory is everyone should get that, there's 460,000 college athletes, that's $92 billion. And if you just took one women's team, which by the way is never gonna get paid under Dr. Edwards' model, that there's 15 players, that's $25 million that you would have to pay. So that may be a good thing for people to receive the money, that's a different thing, but do we think that's gonna change the incentives in college sports in every way, including health and safety? I do.
So in terms of honoring and respecting the athletes, if you were at Stanford today and you became the editor of the Stanford newspaper, the school would pay you $50,000. Is that disrespectful and not honoring that Stanford student for doing that? And by the way, the school newspaper doesn't generate much money for the school. And it's work that the athlete, that the student loves doing. But if you're a football player at Stanford, maybe a black football player at Stanford, it doesn't matter whether you're black or white, okay? And they want to put aside $50,000 for that athlete in a health fund, so if they end up with the type of problems that football players end up with later in life, guess what? The NCAA says, no, you can't do that because that's disrespecting the athlete. That's not honoring the athletes. That's giving the athlete the wrong incentive. No one said it was the wrong incentive for that kid on the newspaper saying, well, you're not going to devote enough time to your class because you're being paid for the newspaper. By the way, in Stanford, if you want to become like an internet entrepreneur, they'll give you a $100,000 interest-free loan. Okay? You can't give that loan to the athlete to take care of his needs despite what they are generating for this sport. And Beth is quite right. There isn't money to do this for all the athletes in all the sports. I agree with that, okay? We're talking about the sports that have become big businesses. They're not the same. When you're at the University of Texas and you decide to have a commercial television business, which they do, Longhorn TV, check it out, okay? That has nothing to do with their educational mission. It has everything to do with their commercial enterprise, and they get free exploited labor for doing that. Those athletes deserve a piece of that pie. They deserve to bring it back to their communities, and you can let the conferences regulate it so it won't all go to the superstars. Maybe it'll go to things like their health care. Maybe it'll go to things like to incentivize them to their studies. I have no problem with eligibility rules. Make them go to school and make advances to their degrees. I do agree, being a student has a great value.
But Jeff, don't you think those women on the basketball team work just as hard as the men on the basketball team?
Oh, they should get every bit of it because they
But there's no money there.
Oh, no. If you looked at the finances of women's basketball at those schools, and by the way, the Texas women have a very great team. And they are a proud team, and they deserve exactly the same compensation for women's basketball as men's basketball. I absolutely agree with that, and you should agree with it too.
Bart, what are your thoughts?
Let me just add one thing, because this is getting pretty mixed up. Look, the compensation that the school can give, I would not disagree with that with paying the athlete something, but look, why is it that the money for the shoe deals goes to the athletic department when it's the athletes who are wearing the shoes? Nobody's going to come and see Nick Saban play football. And the idea that it'll only be a few superstars, isn't the whole team is wearing Nike shoes or Puma shoes or Adidas shoes. So rather than this, why can't these athletes receive compensation for the jerseys that they wear, for the shoes that they wear, and the whole team, and the women's team are out there wearing gym shoes. They're not playing basketball barefooted. They're wearing the same shoes that the school has a contract for. But all of the money goes to the school. Nothing goes to the athletes. And if you add to that even just minimally humane, decent pay out of the money that they're generating, it wouldn't break the bank and women could be included. So all I'm saying is that they can figure out a way for everybody to get paid. But when it comes down to the athlete, they can't figure out a way to compensate the athlete. And nobody is saying that if you compensate the athlete, you quit educating them. I went to school on an athletic scholarship. My old man couldn't afford to send me across town on a bus. But I wound up from East St. Louis all the way out to California because of an athletic scholarship. And so what I'm saying is you don't quit funding the education. You simply open it up so that the athletes who are producing the money get some aspect of the money. And if the money is going to corrupt these kids, then what in the hell is it doing to the old folks? Maybe that's the problem. The money done corrupted them to the place that they don't see that the kids should get anything. I mean, we look.
Thank you, Dr. Edwards. We're running low on time, and there are a few other things I did want to talk about, and that is, how has social media really changed modern sports? And I'd like to start with you, Bart, because we haven't
heard
from
you. I'm sorry. What was the question?
Social media. How has it changed modern sports?
You know, the whole topic of social media is not one that I'm particularly familiar with. I mean, as I understand the issue. There are athletes who have a social media presence, and there are limitations on their ability to play their sport if certain things happen in connection with their social media presence. And I believe that the rules that would obtain there are the rules that limit compensation going to athletes who are participating in their sports. And so if there's a linkage between their social media presence and their sports participation, that's where the NCAA steps in. But I don't know that there are a lot of examples of it, but I would imagine that as time goes on and as athletes in their high school years, the more well-known you are as an athlete, the higher your social Sure. media presence. And so I do believe that the issue will be more and more prevalent as time goes on. But in terms of having a prediction about the future, I really don't have one.
Sure. Gary, what are your thoughts on the interplay between social media and sports?
Thank God it wasn't around when I was at Cal. I mean, just the experience of my own children and sharing too much, I just think it puts so much pressure on these athletes in college. You know, clearly, yeah, if you're paying people, that's going to put a ton of pressure on them. There is pressure for every college athlete, but I think there's even more when you start paying them, because there will be Nick Saban telling you, yelling in your face, because he's not a Boy Scout teacher, instructor. He's a coach making $11 million. He's going to get in your face and tell you how much they're paying you and to pull your head out of that place and get it done. And so, you know, anything that happens in social media that a coach can pick up on, I mean, it just, again, I think it's just more pressure that's going to be placed on the college athlete.
Okay. And a related question, Beth, how much do you think an athlete should be able to control their own image?
Well, I think that's an interesting question. I don't actually have the answer to that. Because I think it's complicated by the individual athlete and the team. But on the social media front, you know, one of the great threats that's coming down the road is gambling. I am on a panel for professional tennis looking at the problem with corruption in tennis worldwide. And the combination of social media, where tennis players, especially women tennis players, are harassed and threatened through social media, where they are blackmailed and there are, you know, payoffs to win matches, lose matches, or even just, you know, double fault on your serve. There is a problem around the world with that, with betting. And in our country now, we're saying betting is going to be allowed throughout the country. And I think that, with social media on college athletics, and if you pay athletes, you're going to have the perfect storm, because you're going to have these athletes who are making a lot of money, and as you're saying, Gary, with the pressure of social media and their coaches saying you're getting paid all this money. And I think it's going to be very, very difficult for student athletes in any event, but if they're being paid in some kind of market system, certainly people, not just the coaches now, but the people betting, are going to expect certain performance from those athletes.
So just three comments on social media. Obviously, there are a lot of negatives that could be involved in social media for all sorts of reasons, but let's focus on some positives. It has given many athletes a voice. Many athletes today are using social media to speak out about some of the most important social issues of our time, and I think they deserve to be commended. That has not always been true through generations of athletes, although Professor Edwards knows of some pioneers in that regard, says, but I think that's been a terrific plus of social media. The second thing about social media is it's another example of what I view as the hypocritical nature of the current regulations. So some of you may be young enough or have a child who's young enough to know about esports. Okay, esports are this burgeoning industry in video game play that is quite popular about people who are somewhat younger than I am in terms of that. And it's a very exciting enterprise. On colleges right now, there are esports teams, and yet the esport athletes, not regulated by the NCAA, and they're quite popular sports, are able to go onto social media and earn revenues promoting themselves. But that's part of how that industry works in terms of that. But they're not subject to NCAA regulation right now. And guess what? Has that sport collapsed? No. Have those students stopped going to school? No. Has the world come down as we know it because they've been able to so far escape the NCAA's regulations to prevent that? No. It's a great example of why you don't need the current system to restrict all this. And finally, I just say, I have problems in understanding the issue about gambling somehow making this worse. Okay? If you have a poor person with no money and you approach them about gambling, okay, that's a problem. if the athletes can be fairly compensated to some degree and don't have to worry about going hungry at night, as happened a few years ago with an NCAA champion athlete in Connecticut who said at night he couldn't afford pizza, then you have to worry about gambling as a problem. And in fact, that's been exactly the issue in tennis. It's not been the highly compensated tennis players, it's been those who don't make any money at all. So on all these grounds, it seems to me the case today for relaxing these rules and letting the sunshine in of competition is greater than ever before.
So we have just a couple minutes left. Dr. Edwards, can you share with us a little bit about the effect that social media has had on the Kaepernick story?
Let me just give one example of what we experienced with the social media. At one point, we noticed a tremendous change in the anatomical features and so forth of the athletes. And in a study that I did, I looked back and found out what the deal was. The year that that Tony Dungy and the Indianapolis Colts won the Super Bowl, I looked at the athletes in Rival.com, the offensive and defensive linemen. And what had happened was so many of these linemen had bulked themselves up based on the rankings that were online. These athletes are ranked online. And an athlete may not be as great an athletic individual, but he can get bigger. And so all of a sudden you have these athletes blowing themselves up. And the year that the Indianapolis Colts won the Super Bowl, the average weight of the offensive and defensive linemen coming out of high school at 17 and 18 years old was higher than the average weight of the Indianapolis Colts offensive and defensive linemen who had won the Super Bowl. I mean, you had athletes at 18 years old at 330 pounds because they look at the rankings, at the rival.com rankings, and all of a sudden there are three people ahead of them who are just a little, and so they blow themselves, well, I'll be bigger. I'll look more like an offensive lineman. And so that's one impact that we noticed over the years. When I first went to the 49ers, there were three players in the NFL who weighed over 300 pounds. Now, if you don't weigh 300 pounds, you almost can't play on the offensive line. I mean, this has been an impact of the social media coming out of high school. So that's one thing that I think is deleterious, and I couldn't agree more with the gambling thing. The thing that worried me more than anything else about this gambling regulation that just came down for sports is not that athletes will have money to gamble, but that people will come to them because they don't have money and say, hey, we're not asking you to lose the game. We're just asking you to miss that free throw. Mm-hmm. We're just asking you to shank that punt. We're just asking you to miss that tackle or drop that pass. This is a real challenge, and it goes back to compensating these kids for the work that they do.
So we have just 2 minutes left. I'd just like to ask each of you for your final comments.
I guess what I would start by saying is that the reality is, if you take all this stuff into account and you look at what's happening at universities right now around the country with their sports, which are funded, again, by the one or two sports on campus that may make money, and at many campuses it's only one sport, at some most campuses in America it's none that actually operate in the green or the black. But at the same time, you've got universities like Eastern Michigan, UCLA and Miami dropping sports that they're famous for. So UCLA doesn't have men swimming anymore. Eastern Michigan doesn't have swimming or diving or wrestling, which they're famous for. To say that the money isn't tight in college athletics is just inaccurate. Yes, there are outliers that have lots of money, but the typical universities don't. And it's being funded by the money from the NCAA tournament and a few other places.
Jeff?
So if you're a fan of Division III sports, my son was a Division III football player at Pomona, did a good job there. No one makes any money on their sports at Division III, yet all the sports are funded. How does that happen? How does the English department get funded? How does the French department get funded? This idea that the poor minority athletes generating hundreds of millions of dollars should get nothing because somehow you're not going to be able to keep the rowing team going is a canard. Okay, if schools can't afford to do something, they won't. And let's be very clear about that. No one is asking to pass a law that says schools must pay this money. What we're asking for is to let schools and conferences make their own choices. If we trust those educators, they will do the right things. They won't spend money they don't have. They won't spend it unwisely, but they will spend it to better reward those athletes who give so much with their bodies and their health and everything, female and male, to generate those revenues for those schools.
So we're now over time, but Beth, Gary, do you have any final comments?
I'm good.
Okay. I'm good. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Let's thank this panel.